Okay, everybody, this is Dr. Ed Park from Recharge Biomedical, and we're going to talk about male sexual health today. As a warning, this topic is not for everyone. I'm sure that it will offend some people. If you are one of those people that gets offended by talking about sex, then I would not listen. I would hang up. Sex is an uncomfortable topic, and people joke about it, and what's funny to you may not be funny to me, or vice versa. So if you'd rather not be offended, and if you can't stand the sight of an erect penis, then I wouldn't watch. It won't be anything pornographic, but that is the topic today, male sexual health. The topic of female sexual health we may have someday, but today is male sexual health, and that implies erections. So if you're offended by erections, please do not listen. Okay, disclaimer. There we go. So today we're going to hear from some patients who talk about their sexual function. First slide is an interesting slide about lust, or what makes people want to have sex. Because humans have sex not just for procreative reasons, their estrus, or the time when the woman is most fertile, is hidden by and large. So with some animals and primates, you know when the female is in heat and ovulating, but for some reason, the humans, that's disguised. But what we're looking at here, this is physical touch, erogenous zones on the right, upper right. On the lower right are all the smells that can be erogenous. Of course, erogenous from eros for the god of love and genus for creating or growing. Sounds, sexy ways to talk or the content of what you say. And here, sight, the visual aspect of sexual arousal, and different for men and women. So what's known is that for men, the hourglass shape is generally an attractor, and for women, the V shape is generally an attractor, just in gross physical terms. Okay, here's a slide talking about the biochemical basis of love or lust. So let's just examine real quickly. The master regulators of mood in general, but of pleasure in particular, are dopamine, norepinephrine, and serotonin, and various growth factors. So if you have the, your breath gets short, someone takes your breath away, so to speak, then it could be a physical attraction. Also pheromones, people try and use bacon-scented perfume to attract men. I don't know how that works. And of course, master regulators in men and women are testosterone, and it's thought perhaps estrogen in women, though that's less established. Attachment is mediated by oxytocin and vasopressin, and this oxytocin is released by breastfeeding, and so it makes sense that evolutionarily speaking, the woman would be bonding with the baby, but also in the refractory postcoital state, the men's oxytocin and prolactin levels shoot up. So it's a bunch of chemicals, a very complicated thing. And I think we missed the quote here by one of my favorite comedians, Larry David.
Yesterday, it was actually right after you left, a miracle happened. Have you ever witnessed a miracle like that?
No.
I mean, can you think of one like that?
I think every erection is a miracle.
Anyway.
In a way, that is true. Today, we're going to talk about what can go wrong, and there's a ton that can go wrong as the guy gets older. Some of you may remember this from high school health class or hygiene. The people who studied the so-called human sexual response like to break it into three formal stages. The first would be excitement. This would have physical analogs in terms of perhaps genital engorgement. The labia could become swollen, the glands, penis erect. There could be lubrication. And definite pupil dilate, different things going on. The plateau phase can precede what's called orgasm. And, of course, with men, that's usually associated with ejaculation or release of semen. For women, they reach plateau and are able, after a shorter refractory period, to have repeated orgasms a little easier than most men. There's a refractory period where they cannot achieve orgasm. And again, today's topic is sexual stuff, and if you're offended by talking about sex or listening to people talk about sex, I would urge you to hang up at this point. If you're below the age of 18, you should not be listening as well. Okay. All right. This is probably, depending on your point of view, the most offensive slide of the presentation, or humorous. I'm not sure what was going on here, but obviously when young men have difficult time sometimes controlling their erections, so here's four guys who it looks like they just won a crew race, and for some reason, unless this was digitally mastered, they don't appear to be hiding their goods very well. Maybe they're excited, maybe it's... I'll let you speculate. For erectile function, a younger man can experience it just from visual stimulation. In their mid-40s, men start to report that they can be sexually aroused even in the absence of erection, which is interesting. Here is the illustration. The artery dilates. More blood comes into these spongy caverns, the corpora cavernosa and the corpus spongiosum. And so the blood fills. And a compartment syndrome occurs. The artery, the blood here compresses the veins. The blood can't leave as easily. And that is an erection. With regard to erectile dysfunction, I made up this acronym called PANTS. So if you have problems, you need to check your PANTS. The first would be psychological problems. Second would be arteries, circulatory, which would be contributed by various vascular damage, atherosclerosis, high blood pressure, diabetes. The N in parents is neurological problems. Big one is after prostate surgery or even things like degenerative diseases like Alzheimer's and multiple sclerosis. T is for testosterone. Of course, the hypogonadism or the decrease in testosterone that accompanies aging is a big factor. And S would be side effects of medications and drugs. So there's a lot of ways that an erection can fail. And different pills will address different aspects of this. First one is P in pants, psychological. So one's mood and affect can affect sexual function. What are we talking about in terms of psychology versus neurology? Psychology, not thought disorders, like people who are schizophrenic, we're talking about mood disorders, and that would include depression. And, of course, depression, people take a popular class of drugs called SSRIs or Prozac. Some people medicate their depression with alcohol or drug use. And then what's called the secondary axis, there's also people who have personality disorders or ways of relating to the world that can be dysfunctional, your ability to have sexual function. So with regard to mood, the self-worth, some people think anger is, or depression is anger turned inwards. I don't know if that's universal, but that's an aspect certainly of the feelings of self, low self-esteem. Another aspect of depression, whether it be major depression or just episodic dysphoria, would be anhedonia. An, not hedon, like hedonism, enjoyment. So the inability to enjoy things that normally would give you pleasure, not enjoyable. Also poor communication. People are internally preoccupied with their own problems, and they generally become withdrawn. Another component would be the anxiety component, of which the adrenergic or the flight or fight response is chronically and tonically activated. Stress is also the stress hormone, which activates glucose mobilization and just generally messes with your consciousness and your sleep quality. And then also, people who are depressed often have conflict with their sexual partners, leading to a lack of intimacy. And of course, if there is no intimacy, then although the meaning of sexual behavior can be varied, a predominant one is one of bonding, which would be very, very impaired if you are fighting and depressed and all that. So let's listen to our first testimonial of a 47-year-old man who had a dramatic improvement in 1 week. And the reason he comes under P is because 1 week is not usually enough to do a lot of genetic remodeling in your stem cells. So there has to be a psychological component here. Let's listen.
Anyway, let me just, so you feel like the sex is better? In what way? In what ways?
I guess my ability to achieve orgasm with a condom on is better. My stamina is better. The thing is that it happened within a week, and so it wasn't, I'm not sure what else I could attribute it to, but it surprised me that it was so quick.
Okay. So clearly, without giving out any patient confidentiality, this gentleman was battling with some alcohol, lifelong alcohol use. And so, in keeping with the upward spiral, he decided to quit drinking at the same time he was taking T65. So that would have relieved a lot of the problems related to depression, and perhaps he was in a better place with his girlfriend. But as he had a girlfriend and not a long-term monogamous partner, he was using condoms and finding that he was unable to always sustain, he couldn't always sustain an erection to ejaculation, which changed pretty quickly for him. The A is arterial in pants. So, again, the circulation of the penis is supplied by these arteries. And so the way the erection works is that the arteries dilate, letting blood into the penis. And because it's like a compartment syndrome, the balloon inflates, and because the veins are softer and not as solid, the veins get smushed. So the blood can come in, but the blood can't go out. And that is what causes an erection. When we talk about erectile dysfunction, there's one very interesting litmus test, which is the nocturnal penile tumescence, which happens during REM sleep. So here's, I presume, a guy happy about seeing something there. And people colloquially call it morning wood or morning glory, but it's normal for men to have erections during REM sleep. People think it could be because of a loss of the adrenergic suppression from this point in the brain. So lack of control all of a sudden permits the erection to come up. Same as if you are psychologically stressed, like say you're trying to do Mrs. Robinson's brassiere, that stress response might cause an inability to achieve an erection. Interestingly, the bladder reflex through the sacral nerves S2 and 4 will also create an erection, even in people who are quadriplegic. So when the bladder is full, there's a feedback loop which will cause an erection, which has a secondary benefit of not leaking while you're sleeping. So it's not always a sexual thing. This is what people will do is put stamps around the penis. And so, I mean, there's more sophisticated ways to measure it precisely, but if you have an erection, then the stamps will, I guess, tear unbeknownst to you. So that's a way of determining whether it's physical, i.e. the arteries are messed up, or is it something else? And again, the differential diagnosis or the list of things that can cause failure to launch is pretty long. So let's listen to number two testimonial of a 69-year-old man who's been taking two capsules for 6 months.
How has the sexual function been?
You know, I think it's actually considerably improved. There's I would say with regard to spontaneous erections, they've been considerably increased in number. Mostly as they used to be, you know, you're younger in the morning, but also the ability to reach, you know, that stage has been reduced, and also I would say the
you mean the time it takes
has been increased.
The time it takes to get an erection, is that what you mean?
Yeah, decreased.
Okay. Now, had you used erectile dysfunction medication in the past?
Oh, I've tried it. I have like on maybe once or twice at night, but now I don't really.
Okay.
Don't really need it.
So what would you say the frequency of sexual things was? What was the difference between your ejaculation before TA and now?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's maybe a bit more intense.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of weekly ejaculations, what would be the difference?
Well, maybe a little more frequency because there's more desire.
Okay.
You know, it seems like it, but it happens spontaneously more, you know, like at certain times, particularly after things like a workout or things like that, it would be, you know, the desire is increased. And I'd say the number of frequency is increased, too, maybe by 30%.
Okay, so maybe you're sexually active 3 times a week now, or?
Yeah, it could be. That's probably about right.
Okay, so moving right along, we see the traditional model of atherosclerosis, in which tens of billions of dollars has been invested, is reductionist. It's they basically go down to the individual players. It's not holistic. So they look at LDL, free radicals, the damage that happens to the intima or the lining of the cells is addressed by your immune system in the terms of macrophages and T cells, which go in and make foam cells. So basically, over time, and this process can occur even as a child, turbulent flow, high cholesterol, endothelial damage, these things lead to a process which is not reversible, but which can eventually cause blockage, thickening of the artery walls, and eventually if there's a fissure, the acute clot will form and it can block off blood to that organ, leading to a heart attack or stroke or even more minor problems. So, I'm not knocking the traditional atherosclerotic model. It is true, but again, people are treating cholesterol-lowering drugs. They're taking antioxidants, which is all good. But let's look at the root causes. Perhaps they are the cells in the arteries are getting old. They're not as efficient. The immune system isn't as good at clearing the damage. There's the metabolic syndrome, which we talked at great length about last week, which is looking like it's due to cellular aging. So I'm proposing, what about an endothelial aging stem cell model of atherosclerosis? And we'll get into that in a future podcast, I'm quite certain. But my point is that if you look at my blog, there's an article I wrote about why hypertension in particular is not a disease. It's a normal adaptation to getting older and to having less efficient arterial function. So I believe that what we're looking at are manifestations of just normal aging. The N is neurology, or the nerves, the electrical circuits to the penis. And these are often damaged surgery. even bike riding, they now have bicycle seats with ridges down the middle, so there's not that crush damage to the penile nerve. Alzheimer's, multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's work centrally, and then also diabetes is known to cause nerve damage globally, as well as microcirculatory damage. So here's a quote from Emperor Marcus Aurelius, who was also quite the philosopher and self-made guy. And he said that in one of his musings that, and in the case of things having to do with sexual union, friction of the genitals with the excretion of mucus in spasms is all that love amounts to. So, real fun guy to have at parties, I'm sure. I probably want to go with Nero or Claudius if you were throwing a rager. So let's listen to a gentleman who's older, 80 years old. Again, not to be offensive, but I'm trying to hold a conversation with him in this, and you can tell there's some, you know, Alzheimer's there. But delightful gentleman nonetheless, and we'll hear what he has to say about when he first started taking. He was having sex for the first time in a while, but of course nothing, he wasn't ejaculating. And so let's hear what he has to say, 80 years old.
You said that you had been sexually active but unable to really climax?
Yeah.
Are you still sexually active?
Well, I'll try, yeah.
Okay, so still not able to climax?
Pardon me?
Are you able to achieve orgasm?
Oh, yeah.
Since when?
Well, oh God, I can't. I really don't know.
Well, we spoke about a month and a half ago. You said you were having trouble reaching orgasm or climaxing.
Yeah.
Have you been any different since then?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Can you elaborate?
Well, it takes quite a while, but, you know.
So, since we last spoke, you've actually been able to orgasm?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, that's news, huh?
Yes.
So, when was the last time before that?
Oh, gosh.
Who was in the White House? Carter?
No.
Wasn't that long ago, right?
I suppose it had probably been 2.5 years.
Oh, okay. Just a few years.
Yeah.
Okay, so he's a delightful young guy, but yeah, I guess he's having intercourse, and yeah, that's something new for him. Okay, it was just a sweet guy, but he couldn't really follow the train of thinking, I don't think, too well, but nonetheless, where there's sex, there's life, I suppose, for him, so more power to him. The T is testosterone, and of course, if you've watched TV, there's commercials for low T. Low T is normal. Your testosterone declines as you get older. And as we talked about in podcast 11 about exercise, after 25, invariably everything is downhill, including testosterone. And testosterone is the primary hormone of desire, as I'm sure you might know, and perhaps one of the reasons why the gentleman was having more desire after exercise, perhaps testosterone was being released. Okay, so 52-year-old man taking invariably 1 to 4 capsules, he would often forget to bring his bottle. And let's see what he has to say. Although he, as a 52-year-old, is kind of an outlier in terms of his experience sexually, and I think you'll see why.
And that you had visited her in Europe. Can you compare the time that you forgot to bring the bottle with the time that you brought the bottle in terms of frequency?
Oh, well, I would say it was double.
Hmm.
Or maybe a little over double.
Okay, so like how many times were you doing it a day?
3 to 4
times a day?
Yeah.
And for how many days was that?
10.
Wow.
So somehow we stumbled upon a very high-performing gentleman. I guess that was, if you're doing the math, 30 times in 10 days. So I'm not sure that that's any kind of normal behavior, but certainly a very positive part of his lifestyle. S in pants is side effects. So this is huge. Beta blockers, anything for high blood pressure that ends in allol, like metoprolol or atenolol, these are beta blockers, and so they block some of the signals in the autonomic nervous system, and that can impede erectile function. Prozac, Zoloft, as we mentioned, are antidepressants, and one of the major side effects, also through their actions on the noradrenergic response, probably, is to cause erectile dysfunction. Smoking, perhaps mediated by vascular damage, causes impotence as well. And a recent study in the last 2 months showed that people who use chronic NSAIDs, ibuprofen, at least 3 times a day for 3 months, have an increased rate of impotence, 22% increase. So that's interesting. Also, alcohol. I'm not a drinker, so I didn't really realize that, but apparently alcohol causes some performance issues. And so this is a young man, not to imply anything, just for humor. So if you're a Pittsburgh Steelers fan, please do not write to me or have your attorney contact me. But here, let's hear from a 40-year-old man who's been taking 3 to 4 capsules a day for 3 months. Okay, so he brings up an interesting point, which is it doesn't do anything you can feel, and that's absolutely true, and that's part of the greatness of this and part of the challenge. People don't know if it's doing anything, so there is no psychotropic effect. Also, we talked to the 80-year-old gentleman, and you might be asking yourself, well, is that normal at his age? So the people who are interested in what quote-unquote normal is are the Kinsey people. The Institute persists. And at the end, if you stay on, you'll see a survey of what is normal. This slide is just illustrating the discovery of nitric oxide, which is the little gas that your body produces that is activated by, or the degradation is inhibited by Viagra. That won a Nobel Prize in 1998, and so that's what keeps a lot of things perfused well, and it's the central mediator of the male sexual response in the corpus cavernosum. So I kind of a little joke there. Went from NO, which is nitric oxide, to YES, which is this this guy here. I'm trying to do something. Here is another Nobel Prize in 2009, which many of you probably know, was for the discovery of telomerase. And telomerase is the enzyme which is activated by T65, and it causes accelerated and more efficient replication of stem cells and stem cell healing. And so these pills, white pills, as we discussed in last week's webinar, helped me to lose weight and are helping a lot of other people get younger. And if you have questions, just type them into the chat box, or you can raise a flag next to your name and you can ask it live. David asks, how often would you have to take T65 to have the desired effect? Seems the dosage varies. I presume you're talking about improved male function, and so, you know, it can range. If you have a psychological imperiled gentleman who was getting on the wagon and dealing with depression, he was shocked that it happened so quickly. But psychological effects can be quick. The 80-year-old gentleman has problems on many levels, probably. Central neurological problems, vascular problems, low testosterone. I mean, he's got all the five letters of pants is probably at work there. So he's going to, you don't get old overnight, you don't get young overnight. So everybody is different. I hope that answers your question, David. Again, the effects of TA65 are none. It's merely a panacea. And what I mean by that is nature's panacea is telomerase. So on every cell that needs to copy itself, telomerase is nature's way of preserving and protecting that cell. And the only thing that TA65 appears to do is to make your normal nightly healing or daily healing go from like a 70-80% efficiency to like 120% efficiency. And so all the good effects are totally individual to what you need to get younger. Any other questions? Thank you, David. Bernie asks the question, is it best to take TA65 before bed, correct? I don't want to answer that because I know that the company has different recommendations and all the other physicians have different recommendations, but I think the current recommendation is to take it in the morning with an empty stomach with water. I actually do not agree with any of those, and that's just empirical. So if you have a relationship with us and we're following you and we record those calls and we learn from you, I think we have better ways to absorb it, but again, I don't want to interfere with the physician-patient relationship that anybody might have, so I'm a little hesitant to answer that question. Bob Lynn, my girlfriend is praying I win the raffle. Okay. Can I get my BPs measured at your office, and what is the charge for the test? Yes, base pairs, I assume you mean the length of the telomeres. The charge for the test, it can vary, but in general, the price has gone down. The official price is $800, but we're only charging $4 at this point. And when Blasco's test, who was featured in podcast, I believe it was 13, about how does TA65 work, when her test comes online, which is measuring the shortest telomeres, I think that's the only test we'll be wanting to do. Because I don't think the average length is that relevant, but it is better than nothing. But the Blasco test is much more relevant to clinical outcome. And so actually, a couple of weeks ago, we went down and visited the oldest. She'll be 112 in August. So I'm sure that her telomeres show extremely efficient healing of the critically short end. So, yeah. Pictured here is Bill Harrington, who very justly does listen to a lot of the webcasts or podcasts, so he, as fate would have it, won the bottle a few weeks back. The second raffle, actually not a single person that we picked responded to their emails. Can you imagine? So nobody wanted it, I guess. If you're on our email list, you do have a chance, even if you don't attend, but if you attend, you have a 10 times chance. All right, we have the winners. Are you going to type? Ken asks, when will the new telomere test be on ABC News with Diane Sawyer? And at that time, they were looking at a summer release time in the United Kingdom, approximately $700, but I have no idea. I know that Dr. Blasco did request some of our patients, 112-year-old patients' blood, so hopefully she'll do something interesting there with that. The other people that received the blood were Telome Health, which I'm not sure if they're gonna commercialize a measurement of your telomeres as well. Not sure if they're planning on doing the same model, but yeah, that's the head scientist of Geron, former is Cal Hartley, and the Nobel Prize winner Elizabeth Blackburn. I have a startup in Menlo Park called Telome Health, T-E-L-O-M-E. So they'll be bringing something commercially available. The mean white blood cell measurement has been available for some time now. I'm going to say at least 6 years. And that's done in Canada, and now I think there's at least one lab doing it in the U.S. The winners, James, the Burge, Shirley Stearns. I just spoke with her last night, so she'll be thrilled if nobody else is on the call. No info. Naru A, no info. Mike Restaino. Kent Meyer. Oh, he's perhaps, yes, he is on. You better hope Shirley Stearns is not. I think Kent is a winner. Congratulations, Kent Meyer. You just got a bonus bottle, my friend. And, yeah, so the webinar will be off for 2 weeks. I got a lot of catch-up work to do, and I'm going to go up to Pebble Beach next week and talk with a lot of the pros. We got four of them, I think, taking it now, and hopefully get the word out. If anybody knows any major league pitchers who tear up their rotator cuff on a routine basis, send them our way, because I think the damage to that repairs quite quickly, as we discussed in podcast 11. Which reminds me that in 2 weeks, or 3 weeks perhaps, we're going to talk about Lulu, the black lab. And Lulu is a much-loved pet of patient Kathy, and she has been taking TA65. You can see here with her partner or friend. There's four legs on that dog, but Lulu had a complete amputation to the shoulder of her left front. And so she was battling, or is battling, a lymphosarcoma, which perhaps metastasized to the lung. But apparently she's doing very well subjectively and objectively, so we'll review that on July 20th, I believe. And it should be a good one. I know Lulu's getting her fifth and final chemo in about a week, so we pray for the best there. Okay, everybody, this is Dr. Ed Park completing a webinar podcast on male sexual function. And I want to thank everybody for the attendance, and thank everybody for keeping me out of their spam box, I hope. I know that there can be a lot of noise in your inbox, but hopefully we're providing a little more information than the average spam. So, again, you might miss out on some things if you keep us in your spam box. So, again, thanks, everybody, for tuning in. Bye-bye.
I'm not talking about my driver either.
No.